Russia reports over 14,700 new infections Sunday. That's the largest one-day national caseload in 4 months. Nearly half of those cases were from the capital, Moscow. The city's mayor on Saturday told people to stay off work this week to combat the surge in infections. He also ordered bars, restaurants, and venues to close by 11 in the evening. In a bid to get more people vaccinated, the mayor is giving away cars in a raffle draw. President Joe Biden agrees that U.S.-Russia relations are at a low point, but Biden says he is open to resolve conflict and work together with Russian President Vladimir Putin. This report.
Well, let me make it clear. I think he's right. It's a low point.
U.S. President Joe Biden on Sunday said that Russian leader Vladimir Putin was right to say that relations between the two former Cold War foes were at their lowest point in years, and suggested Russia might be weaker than it seemed.
Russia has its own dilemmas, let us say, dealing with its economy, dealing with COVID. They have also bitten off some real problems they're going to have trouble chewing on. And for example, the rebuilding of Syria, of Libya.
Biden's comments came at the tail end of the G7 summit in England and just days ahead of his Wednesday meeting with Putin in Geneva that promises to be a combative encounter given the two countries' disputes over spying, hacking, election meddling, Ukraine, Belarus, and human rights. Asked why Putin had not changed despite years of Western sanctions, Biden quipped,
"He's Vladimir Putin. Autocrats have enormous power. They don't have to answer to a public. And the fact is that it may very well be, if I respond in kind, which I will, that it doesn't dissuade him. He wants to keep going."
Biden was also asked why he and Putin will hold separate press conferences after their meeting rather than facing the media together.
"This is not a contest about who can do better in front of a press conference or try to embarrass each other. He can say what he said the meeting was about, and I will say what I think the meeting was about."
The president also stressed he was not looking for conflict with Russia, but rather to resolve actions by Putin the U.S. views as, quote, inconsistent with international norms, and to work together on issues like Syria and on climate change. Biden is attending a two-day NATO summit in Brussels this week prior to his meeting with Putin.
The G7 nations pledged to provide 1 billion COVID-19 vaccines to poor countries still left many bitterly disappointed. This report tells us why.
British Prime Minister Boris Johnson said on Sunday that the G7 nations have pledged to provide 1 billion COVID-19 vaccinations to help boost vaccination campaigns in poorer countries. During a news conference following the conclusion of the summit in England's Cornwall, Johnson said the pledge was in response to a request by him.
"A week ago, I asked my fellow leaders to help in preparing and providing the doses we need to vaccinate the whole world by the end of 2022. I'm very pleased to announce that this weekend, leaders have pledged over 1 billion doses, either directly or through funding to COVAX. That includes 100 million from the UK to the world's poorest countries, which is another big step towards vaccinating the world."
Experts say Sunday's pledge does not represent entirely new resources, and the donation is far short of the 5 billion to 6 billion shots needed by poorer nations. The plan also doesn't address distribution gaps that could make it difficult to deliver doses. Oxfam's head of inequality policy, Max Lawson, said the charity is bitterly disappointed.
"It's absolutely not enough, and not just Oxfam, the WHO has said we need far, far more. We need them now. And we also need them to share the intellectual property. Developing countries need the rights and the recipes to make their own vaccines, not relying on the charity, the largesse of the G7. So it's completely inadequate on battling the coronavirus crisis."
Stephen Morrison, the director of the Global Health Policy Centre at the Centre for Strategic and International Studies, however, called the move a very significant step.
Still on the G7 summit, the group of seven leaders vowed to coordinate their response to counter and compete with China. In a highly critical final communique, the leaders scolded China over human rights abuses in its Xinjiang region. They also called for a high degree of autonomy for Hong Kong and demanded a full and thorough investigation of the origins of the coronavirus in China. The G7 leaders also offered developing countries an infrastructure plan that could rival Beijing's Belt and Road Initiative.
I think we're in a contest, not with China per se, but a contest with autocrats, autocratic governments around the world, as to whether or not democracies can compete with them in the rapidly changing 21st century. And I think how we act and whether we pull together as democracies is going to determine whether our grandkids look back 15 years from now and say, did they step up? Are democracies as relevant and as powerful as they have been?
Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, meanwhile, acknowledged there are some issues, such as climate change, where the G7 needs to work with China.
We cannot keep the world to less than 1.5 degrees of warming unless China is part of the conversation and indeed the solution. But in many other areas, on the economy, on trade, we will find ourselves in a competitive position with China. We will compete with them. And still in a third area, there will be a need to contest China, particularly in the matters of human rights. And that's where all of us, as a G7 and partners, are aligned in ensuring that we are consistent and united in our approach on these issues.